Hello, my friends. In the last video I recorded, I promised that I'm going to make, if many people press like, I'm going to make a more detailed video about how to be saved. So I was praying to God what to record, how to do it, what angle, because so this is the methodology, as I understand from the Bible. How to be saved. Okay, first of all, we have to know. If you want to know how to be saved, like any other problem we are trying to solve, we want to understand the problem. So we want to know how we got lost in the first place, because that's how, if we understand how we got lost, then we will also see how we can be saved. And we can also see how we can stay saved. How can we avoid getting lost again? Or how can we be not being lost again? Okay? So actually, and the history, when we say how we want to understand how we got lost, that means it's some history. And that history is in the Bible. So the solution, the identification of our lostness, and the solution for how to be saved is actually in the Bible. And in short, this is how it is. The Bible says, all have gone astray, all have sinned, and come short of the glory of God. So, and the Bible also says, the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ. We also have to identify or understand what does it mean to be lost, and what does it mean to be saved. Sometimes we don't know we are lost because we don't know what we are supposed to be originally. We are supposed to live eternally, originally, but because of sin, we die. The wages of sin is death. So now we have to identify also what is sin. Sin, the Bible says, is the transgression of the law. What is the law? The law is God's commandments. The law is God's character. The God's commandments are a reflection of God's character. So when we disobey God's law, then we are lost. We will die. It's like we have a cell phone that gets removed from the power supply, and they are discharged. They are starting to die, getting to be discharged. And we understand that. So why do we have to die, disconnect from God? Because God is life. God is the source of life. He invented us. Okay, He is the source of life. So when we disconnect from life, then we automatically start dying. There's no way for us to live without God. We cannot make ourselves alive. That's why when we die, we cannot resurrect ourselves. But when God, who created us and who invented us, when He says that you raise up from the dead, Lazarus come forth from the dead, as Jesus said in the Bible, Lazarus resurrected from his death. When the angels said to Jesus, "Thy father is calling you," Jesus resurrected himself from the dead. So this is why we know that Jesus Christ is our only hope if we want to be saved. Because Jesus Christ is the only one who can resurrect himself from the dead, and he can also resurrect us from the dead. Our loyalty, there is no other person or being in this world, in this universe, who can resurrect us when we die. That's why we understand that Jesus Christ is the only one who can resurrect us. And therefore, our loyalty should be to Jesus Christ. Don't worry about what people say, what secret societies say, what your friends say. You know, when we all die, do you think they can resurrect us? No. The first priority that we have to obey is Jesus Christ, is God, okay? And then we have also to understand that there is a great controversy. You know why there is sin? Who invented sin? Who is the first person to have sin? You know, we will see in the Bible, in history, that it is Lucifer Sin started from heaven. If you want to avoid sin, you want to know what is the law. And you want to also understand what is sin so that you can avoid sin. So you understand the law and you understand how did people fall and angels fall into sin. And you want to avoid that so that we will not be lost again. So you also want to know the history of sin. In short, this is what happened. In heaven, there was the brightest, the biggest, the strongest angel called Lucifer. But because he was strongest, he was the most talented, he was the most beautiful, the most handsome, the highest position of the angel next to God. There is God the Father, God the Son, and the God the Holy Spirit. And when they created man, they had a meeting by themselves. And Lucifer was a little bit insulted. Why is not he included in that meeting? So he started to develop jealousy. His pride was hurt. That is his number one problem, pride. When he is talented, that's why we have to be careful if we are talented or handsome or beautiful or influential. Pride is the number one problem of Lucifer. We should avoid becoming like Lucifer and becoming proud. We have to understand that we are creatures and God is creator. Our attitude towards God, we have to be submissive to God because He knows everything and we are limited. We are finite or finite. God is infinite, okay? So that is the problem of Lucifer. He started to become jealous. He started to tell lies. You know, telling lies is a sign of being lost because the father of all liars, according to the Bible, is Satan. So what happened with Satan? He started to make lies about God, about His law. He started to question the law of God. That's why there are people who say it's very hard to obey the law. Let's question the law. Let's change the law. That is not a proper way. There are many religions and denominations who don't have a proper perspective or understanding of sin. They don't have proper understanding of salvation and they confuse more people. That's why it's very important to get your idea of salvation directly from the Bible. Okay? You have to validate it from the Bible. Make sure everything is biblical according to the Bible. Not only non-contradictory, but according literally from the Bible. So you want to understand sin. You want to understand the great controversy, Satan versus Satan and his angels versus God and his angels. And how sin entered earth, Satan tempted Adam and Eve, how we fell into sin by food temptation, because and you will see all the history of the world from Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, the whole Bible until you reach Revelation. All how people get saved, how people repent, how people become hard-headed, the Israelites, and when they are hard-headed, how God rebukes them, how God disciplines them, and then they remember God again when they start to suffer and get attacked by the enemies, and they repent and they come back to God, and God drives away their enemies again. And it's like a cycle. You will understand the effects of sin if you read the Bible and you enjoy this history. You will see the patterns of how God is very patient and saving His people without sacrificing the truth, the logic of salvation, because you know we cannot change God's law. And you will also understand how Jesus became the substitution for our sin. Because sin causes death. The wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life. Some people will say that you have to pay to be saved. You have to build a church and so on. That's not in the Bible. You have to be careful about that fundraising idea. That makes money for the church, but it's not biblical. Ephesians 2:8 says, we are saved by grace. And not over works. It is the gift of God. Okay? And then people say, you are just saved. You don't need to do good works. No, Ephesians 2:10 says we are saved so that we will for doing good works. Just go two verses ahead. So it's very important to get the correct understanding of salvation so that we will not be confused. Why are there so many confused understanding about salvation? Because Satan wants to confuse people who want to be saved. He wants people to get lost, and he is inventing all sorts of incorrect religions so that people and lies so that people will be lost. For example, his biggest lie is that we are not going to die, that people don't die when they die. So people will not be serious because they think they don't die. They think they reincarnate. They think they are floating in a between hell and heaven. There's another way. I forgot the term they invented. Like a holding area where you can still negotiate your salvation. No, that is not biblical. When you die, you die. You'll see what happens when we die. That is one of the greatest lies of the enemy, of Satan. So we have to beware about those things. We have to see if what we understand is really in the Bible, because that is the reliable thing. So that is the summary of how to be saved. Basically, we cannot save ourselves. We cannot save ourselves because we are like a banana plant that's slanting to fall down. It cannot save itself unless there is external source to save it, and that's God. God wants us all to be saved. That's the good news. And God is more powerful than Satan. That's the good news. And God has more powerful angels than Satan's angels. Satan only was able to deceive 1/3 of the angels, but God still has 2/3 of the angels, and God can still make many angels. And God created Satan, so there is actually a rules of engagement in the great controversy. When I say great controversy, it is between Satan, between evil and good, God and Satan, and all the people who obey Satan. Okay, so the Bible says, if you believe, you will be saved. That's true. But how do you define believe? That was my question for a long time. If I say you go there and then you don't go there, that means you don't believe me. Now, when we say we believe Jesus, whatever he says, we obey. If Jesus says we will stop doing this, we will stop eating pork, we will stop eating this, we should not eat that, we should believe. You know, we have to believe. Now, how do you know? There are many people who claim, oh, we know Jesus, we love Jesus. The Bible also says that not everyone who says, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but those who obey, who do the will of my Father in heaven. How do we check if we are saved? If we obey God's commandments. And herein we know that we know Him, if we keep His commandments. So how do we check ourselves if we are actually aligned with God? We can check ourselves. It's like looking at the mirror. The law of God is like a mirror. If you want to know if you are aligned with God, look at the Ten Commandments. Look at all the commandments in the Bible. And see if you can, if you are obeying them, then that means you know Jesus and you are his friend and you believe in him. But some people will say, how about all the commandments in the Bible? But there are obsolete commandments there. Yeah, that's a good idea. That's a good question. There are, and in the New Testament, they say that some of the commandments were done away with. Yeah, it's true. Jesus Christ done away with the commandments that were pointing to him. You know, if you look in the Old Testament, there were this, what do you call the ceremonial law. The law about the ceremonies. It's like a ceremony. So all of these things are pointing to Jesus. They are like a symbols that all pointing, like the lamb, the Passover, all of those things. They are symbol of Jesus Christ ministry. Okay, the lamb was symbolizing Jesus. That's why when Jesus came, Jesus died, the offering of lamb was not relevant anymore, was not needed anymore. That was a law before Jesus came, but that was pointing to Jesus. It was a ceremony pointing to Jesus, that so that the Israelites will understand that their sin causes something to die, like the lamb, and it causes blood to be spilled. But when Jesus came, Jesus was the fulfillment of this lamb and sacrifice and ceremony. So those things were done away with. But the Ten Commandments, the right and wrong, how are we supposed to live, how are we supposed to treat our brothers and sisters, and what are we supposed to eat, those things are constant. Those things are not removed. In fact, the disciples still continued the Sabbath. They continued. They did not eat pork. They eat only clean things. Those things still continue. The disciples, even after Jesus left, they still continue to do those things. And the Bible says even in heaven, we are going to worship in the Sabbath in Isaiah. So actually, and then the nice thing is that if you read and enjoy the Bible, you will see in that Jesus Christ is really the center of the whole Bible. In Revelation, the last book of the Bible, it says, the revelation of Jesus Christ. If you look at all these prophecies, they are actually about what Jesus is doing to save us. Wow! If you see that picture, it's so nice. And then you see all the prophecies in Revelation, there are prophecies towards the future, because our time is not finished yet. There are still some things that are going to happen in the future. There are some things that we don't still understand, but these, they are revealed in the book of Revelation, and Daniel and Revelation and other prophecies books in the Bible. So all this whole Bible is actually like a manual of life. It tells us how we got lost. It tells us why the explanation of sin. It tells us what is sin. It identifies the law of God, because you cannot identify sin if you don't know the law. It tells us the hope that Jesus Christ wants to save us. It tells us who our only hope is, that's Jesus Christ. It tells us also how to remain saved, how God continues to save us daily, why Paul says we die daily, because there is we are saved, but we are continuously being saved. Our characters are being corrected. And then when Jesus comes, the Bible says someday Jesus will come and take away all sin and those who don't want to repent. So this is the time where we are supposed to learn what God's law is and ask the Holy Spirit, ask God to help us in our daily life. I think I forgot to explain something a while ago about the rules of engagement. Because Satan respects God. There are things that Satan can do if we allow to do. If we believe him, he can do everything with us. But if we ask God's help, he is supposed to run away. That's the rules of engagement. We have the freedom of choice. If Satan says something and we believe, then we are believers of Satan. If God says something and we believe, then we are believers of God. God does not force us. That is true love. It is not by force. There is choice. We are not robots. So there are rules of engagement. When you play with Satan, then God cannot do anything. He respects your choice. When we obey God, then Satan has to run away. So every day, every minute, every decision, there is a great controversy in our mind, like in Eve. So how do we secure ourselves? We have to continuously be connected with God. We have to ask God for our decision. Lord, should I do this one? Should I do this one? We have to read the Bible so that we will know which is right and which is wrong, which is Satan's suggestion and which is God's idea. So we are in total dependence with God. We cannot do anything. We cannot be saved. And we cannot stay saved if we are not connected with God. Anyway, that is how we are supposed to be kept from sinning, even in the original state. So that is the summary of the whole Bible, the whole great controversy, the mystery of sin, the mystery of salvation, how Jesus Christ takes our place. Jesus Christ dies for us. Why did Jesus Christ die? Because we are supposed to die. But somebody has to die so that the law and the logic and the accounting has to be zero balance. So Jesus Christ said, I will die instead of them. Why not the angels die? Because the angel is not enough. Our sins are so much, this is just my understanding, that one sin causes death. Since we are so many, we might finish all the angels if one person causes one angel death. But when Jesus Christ died for us, he's infinite. So he can also forgive infinite sins. He is the infinite propitiation of our sins, or substitution for our death. So he can save everyone. That's why it's very nice, actually. Jesus Christ is our only hope. And he can resurrect us when we die. So actually, people who believe in Jesus, they don't die. You know why all those martyrs who understood the plan of salvation? why it's okay for them to be eaten by lions, to be persecuted, to be hung, to be crucified, to be shot, to be, you know, it's okay because, so what? You know, Jesus Christ can resurrect us. Whatever we do in this life, if we believe in God, God will resurrect us in the last day when He comes. And then we will live forever. So if you lose your 70-year life, it's okay. If you lose it in God's cause, doing God's cause, believing in God, doing His mission, actually, it doesn't matter if you die now or you die later. You're gonna die. But if you die in Jesus Christ, then He will resurrect you later. And He will give you 1,000 years. The Bible says we will spend a millennium in heaven with God and His angels. And then after that, we will spend forever. We will come back here in this world, where sin is removed. And all the bad things, the sicknesses, the results of sin will be removed. By the way, you will also see in the Bible the results of sin. And you will see what was supposed to be the original in heaven. And after this earth was will be cleansed from sin. So that's the whole picture of how to be saved. How we will be restored to a glorious state, very bright state. My friend, let us pray. Our Father in heaven, we thank you, Lord, for the Bible, for the spirit of prophecy, for the Seventh-day Adventist Church understanding of what is written in the Bible. We thank you for the Holy Spirit who is teaching us how to understand the prophecy, Lord. Thank you so much for dying for us, for forgiving us from our sins, for having a plan of salvation. Help us, Lord, to be humble. Help us to have proper attitude, especially towards you, that you are our creator, you are our boss, you are our Lord, you are our God and our Savior. Help us to be humble. Help us to always pray and listen to the Holy Spirit whispering us to do His will. Help us to be useful in saving others also. Give us wisdom and understanding spiritually so that we will know what is right and what is wrong. And help us to find other people who want to be saved and share the message of salvation, the accurate message of salvation from the Bible. Thank you, Lord, for hearing and answering our prayers. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I hope this helps, my friend. Happy Sabbath. Have a nice week. Good morning. Good night. Bye-bye.